Anyone familiar with East Anglia will recognise this virtually treeless flat landscape, which is the Fens. It's difficult now to believe that a mere 400 or 500 years ago, this was covered in water, or at least treacherous marshes. The lack of towns and villages is perhaps the best indication of the Fens' historical past.
There are a few areas of the kingdom which are least likely to have any connection with the crown, and yet there are some surprising associations. Indeed, it was the influence of the crown which was largely responsible for the shaping of this part of the country.
For centuries, the Fens have provided a natural boundary between the ancient kingdoms of Mercia and Anglia. Now, while both embraced early Christianity and built churches, the Angles seem to excel, and perhaps the most famous rises above the landscape in a spectacular fashion. Ely Cathedral.
Nicknamed the Ship of the Fens, its unique lantern tower is a welcome sight for the lost or weary traveller. However, long before the tower was conceived, the Isle of Ely was the setting for an extraordinary resistance struggle.
The only way to reach the isle was either by boat or along one of the few strips of solid land or causeways like this one. While such knowledge was common in the area, outsiders had to rely on locals to guide them.
When William, Duke of Normandy, invaded in 1066 and killed Harold at Hastings, it was only the beginning of his campaign to conquer England. Being crowned was one thing, convincing his subjects that he was king, quite another. Just how long that actually took is illustrated here at Ely. For 5 years, Ely remained unconquered. It formed the perfect refuge for a semi-mythical figure who led a stubborn resistance to the Norman invaders. He was called Hereward the Wake. One of Hereward's actions actually took place some 26 miles from Ely at Peterborough. The Norman abbot, sent to replace the former Saxon one, arrived with his army to be met by Hereward and his followers. The ensuing battle left the old church badly damaged. William's forces tried to besiege the Isle of Ely, but that proved to be futile, as Hereward's knowledge of the Fens allowed him to move about with ease.
The Normans decided to take the place by force, by building their own causeway. The first one sank, and the second one was set on fire by the defenders. Who knows how long this resistance may have carried on, had Hereward not been betrayed.
The Abbot of Ely began to get extremely nervous about what might happen to him, his monastery, and the inhabitants if the Normans succeeded in getting in. So he arranged for one of his monks to make contact with the Norman camp at Cambridge. In the middle of the night, the monk led William's army to the causeway and safely across the Fens. At first light, they marched into the town, taking the defenders completely by surprise.
Strangely, while the abbey was forced to pay a severe fine to William, who confiscated its lands, it seems that the town and even Hereward escaped punishment.
Long before the days of Hereward, the monastery at Ely had been founded by a Saxon princess, Etheldreda, the daughter of the King of the Angles.
Etheldreda was a member of a royal family, an East Anglian princess, a very strong-minded lady. I think she must have been. I know Sylvia differs in her opinion, but I reckon she was a bit of a battle axe, because somebody who could be married twice, insist on a brother-sister relationship twice, avoid a warring husband who wanted her back, that was the second marriage, and still managed to get her own way. I think at that time that was an incredible, incredible feat. And I suppose it was so novel, a princess wanting to become a nun, and she made it. So, yes, I see her as a bit of a devout battle axe.
And you don't agree?
I don't agree with that, actually. I certainly think that she was strong, and I think if she'd been a lady in the 20th century, she would have been very much an independent woman. She always wanted to be a nun, but for political reasons, she had to be married off. And so the first person she had to marry was Tombert, and he apparently was a lot older than her. And because she knew she wanted to be a nun and lead a religious life, even at a young age, probably about 15 or so, she asked that the contract be made, that she didn't fulfil the conjugal rights of the marriage. And apparently this was agreed. And when Tombert died, she actually inherited this land here. And she decided that she would like to live here and found her convent here. But it didn't last very long, because she was then requested to marry the Prince of Northumbria, which was Egfrith. Now, her second husband was only 15 when she married him, and she was probably nearer 30. But he wanted her to fulfil her conjugal rights later on in life, and he actually went to Bishop Wilfrid and said, who was her confessor, would you please ask Ethelreda to fulfil her marriage obligations? And Wilfrid upheld her desire to be a nun. And so Egfrith had to allow it, or he did allow it, for a time. And then after a while he decided against it, and he tried to make her come back and be his queen. But she ran away from this, and then came back to Ely and found a monastery. And in fact, she founded a double monastery. There were men and women.
She was buried in the nuns' graveyard, but so many people wanted to visit the grave so soon after her death that her sister had her body removed into the cathedral church. And when they opened up the coffin, they found that her body was perfectly preserved, whereas they'd expected to find just nothing but bones. And the doctor who attended her at her death was absolutely amazed at the preservation of the body. And, of course, that spread and confirmed, if you like, sainthood or God's intervention. And Ely then became the great pilgrimage centre visited by thousands and thousands of people.
The whole cathedral, built on the site of the monastery, was designed as a fantastic structure to house the shrine to St. Ethelreda, which throughout the Middle Ages attracted hundreds and thousands of pilgrims.
Extra wide windows were built above Ethelreda's tomb so the sunlight would flood in. The spot is still marked today, even though the original shrine was destroyed at the dissolution. Perhaps the most famous feature of Ely is the incredible lantern. The original Norman tower collapsed in 1322, and the building of this gravity-defying wooden structure was then started. As the English church under Henry VIII broke away from Rome, Ely suffered less than many places from reforming zeal. The destruction of statues, carvings, and windows took place in the Lady Chapel, and St. Ethelreda's shrine was completely destroyed.
Other cathedrals were not so fortunate. Peterborough, for instance, suffered far worse damage during this time, but thankfully, one or two features survived.
If this fan vaulting seems familiar, then it's because it was designed by John Wastell, who went on to build King's College Chapel in Cambridge. This magnificent ceiling in the nave is the largest surviving medieval painted ceiling in Europe. It's difficult to believe, but Roundhead soldiers actually tried to shoot it out with their muskets. Perhaps more surprising still is that Peterborough was the burial place for not one, but two queens. The first to be buried here was Catherine of Aragon, Henry VIII's first wife. When she was just 15, Catherine married Henry's older brother, Arthur. But after just 4 months, Prince Arthur died, whereupon his younger brother, Henry, proposed he marry Catherine.
She steadfastly maintained that the marriage had never been consummated. And when Henry VII died, the two were married in St. Paul's in 1509, and the Spanish ambassador wrote, and I don't see any reason for him to lie, and he said that it was a love match. She truly loves the king, and he is devoted to her. But then they had a series of tragedies, really, over children. Now, altogether, she bore six children, and only one of them survived. And the one that survived was a girl, and from his point of view, a girl didn't count. Because she was unable to produce a male heir, Henry became more and more restive. And there's no doubt that Henry also had a roving eye. He'd had a number of mistresses. He'd had illegitimate children, one of whom was Henry Fitzroy, Duke of Richmond. But he couldn't possibly ascend to the throne, and he needed a legal male heir. And so he came to the position that he had to get rid of Catherine in order to marry someone else. He fell in love with Anne Boleyn, and Anne Boleyn said she wasn't going to be his mistress, it was queen or nothing. And so he was in something of a dilemma.
Although Henry is famous for having six wives, he actually spent more than half his adult life, 20 years in fact, married to Catherine. But with the king marrying Anne Boleyn, Catherine needed to be moved further away from court. In 1533, she was virtually in exile at Buckton Towers near Huntingdon, where, much to Henry's chagrin, she enjoyed tremendous popularity. An incensed Henry sent the Duke of Suffolk to move her elsewhere. Catherine refused and sealed the door against him, insisting she could only be removed by force. An angry crowd of villagers gathered in support of the former queen, carrying scythes and billhooks. Suffolk felt sufficiently intimidated. He withdrew. Despite being banished from court, Catherine remained loyal to the king to the end, even writing a letter to Henry forgiving him for his actions. But she saved probably her most powerful phrase to the very end.
The most amazing words, mine eyes desire to see thee above all other things. After all that she'd gone through, she still loved him at the end. Quite remarkable.
On the other hand, Henry saved his cruelest stroke till last. When Catherine died, he refused permission for her to be buried in Westminster Abbey, and even forbade Mary Tudor, their only daughter, from attending the funeral. Catherine was buried by Robert Scarlett, the local gravedigger. Unfortunately, Scarlett has the rather dubious distinction of burying two queens in Peterborough Cathedral. The second was Mary, Queen of Scots, who spent her final days at nearby Fotheringay Castle. Mary and Elizabeth I were cousins. Queen Elizabeth was increasingly under pressure to end the potential threat that Mary posed. As a legitimate rival for the throne, she was continually the centre of plots to seize the crown. For 18 years, she was kept as a virtual prisoner, but eventually, after the Babington plot of 1586, Elizabeth signed her cousin's death warrant at Hatfield House in Hertfordshire.
She was a very striking woman, very tall, about 6 feet, and with red hair. But when the executioner lifted her head, which had fallen onto the ground, a red wig came off. So obviously she had gone grey and in the latter years been only apparently a redhead.
Catherine of Aragon's tomb suffered badly at the hands of Cromwell's troops, but Mary's tomb escaped thanks to her son, James VI of Scotland and James I of England. He had his mother's remains transferred to Westminster Abbey.
While Peterborough and Ely are very different in many ways, they do have a few things in common. They're both royal foundations. Peterborough is marginally older and was established by Peder, King of Mercia. They were rebuilt by the Normans, both using stone quarried from Barnack near Stamford. They each had to have their central towers replaced, and today they stand in the same county, Cambridgeshire, the only one in England to have two cathedrals. What is more, on a clear day, they can see each other.
For centuries, these two great religious foundations were separated by the watery fens. Practically since man first tried to farm these parts, the challenge has been how to drain them.
Well, the fens always were water, always will be water. Way back, if you go back to the time of Queen Etheldreda and the foundation, the monasteries, they came here because we were a wild and watery landscape. Isolated, we wanted the solitude of being in our fen, in our lovely quiet fen with all our birds and butterflies and reeds.
In the 17th century, the first major scheme to drain the fens was primarily the brainchild of the Duke of Bedford. But local opposition was strong.
About 300 years ago, they dug a new river. The river. They said that would drain the fens. They'd spent so much money on it. 1637, they had a meeting in St. Ives. They said, yes, that's drained, boy. You can have your land. Of course, what happened? Next year, that flooded, didn't it? The banks burst, all the water flooded. All over. We told them, shouldn't muck about with it, but see, they knew better.
The scheme was known to have the full support of Charles I.
However, Charles I's drainage plans brought him into direct conflict with the local population, and most especially, Oliver Cromwell.
Cromwell strongly supported the Fenlanders' objections to these great plans, fearing loss of land and livelihoods. However, the Fens and their customs were to embroil these two men in a little-known saga which might have changed the course of history. In April 1646, King Charles I was attempting to travel through the Fens, which was a strongly parliamentarian area. He employed the assistance of a local man, Mucky Porter, as his guide. Porter was a member of a secret society whose sign was a split grey goose feather. Members were honour-bound to help the bearer of any such symbol. At one point, Porter and the king were stopped by a roundhead patrol. Mucky Porter produced a feather, and the local soldiers allowed them to pass. Cromwell is claimed to have forgiven the patrol, saying that it was better for a king to escape than for a fenman not to help a man who had a split quill in his hand. The story doesn't end there, though. Apparently, the night before Charles was due to be beheaded, a split grey goose feather was sent to Oliver Cromwell. It made no difference. The following day, King Charles I was executed. Cromwell then received a number of bent or broken feathers, sent by men who felt he had betrayed his vows and was therefore no longer trustworthy.
Ironically, after Cromwell had objected so much to Charles's plans, no sooner had he become the Lord Protector than with the new Duke of Bedford, he dug this much bigger river and completed the drainage of the fens.
The postscript to this tale relates to the king's guide, Mucky Porter. After the restoration of the monarchy, Charles II sought out various people who had helped his father. One of them was Porter.
The new king asked him to choose whatever land he wanted, and having pointed out a bit, Charles asked him if he knew how many acres he thought it was. Well, Porter apparently replied, "Ooh, several, I should think." and to this day the area is known as the Severals and is still farmed by the porters.
The drainage work under Cromwell took 4 years. In 1653, parts of the fens were declared dry.
What nobody realised was that when you take the water out, then the level goes down. And see, the problem was that the land levels kept dropping, but the river levels didn't. So you had to put the big banks up beside the rivers to keep the river water in. But then you had to have somewhere pumping the water out the drains and up over these banks into the river. So then they had to start with windmills.
Initially, they were a great success. By the middle of the 18th century, there were almost 700 windmills in the fens. However, the age of the windmill was short. By the 1770s, dozens of them were abandoned to be replaced by steam engines. The need for pumps continues to this day, although now they're electric or diesel. For the fens is a classic example of man continually challenging the forces of nature. It may not look like much of a challenge, but every now and then, nature has a habit of reminding us what a risky business it is, as in 1947.
During March of that year, parts of England suffered very heavy snowfalls, followed by a sudden thaw. The River Ouse was already swollen with all this meltwater when they had to close the sluice gates at the sea because of an exceptionally high tide. The river began to rise, dangerously close to bursting point with all this water and nowhere for it to go.
As the water came across the fens, I could hear it spilling in the dikes. I can hear that sound now when I think about it. And there was, well, hares, rabbits, foxes, all those sort of things, what lived in the fens. They were all turned out in because of the water, you see. And they was all running in front of the water, crying with fear. I did actually have a fox run through my legs. He was so frightened of the water, you see. He didn't see no fear of nobody then. He just run shot through my legs. And it was a sort of thing that, well, you'd never forget it, because it was something that you'd never imagine would happen. And I stood on the middle bridge in our particular fen, and I saw the water coming up, and it was up at the top of the bank as soon as it come. It was the drain was absolutely full and spilling over. And it hit the bridge, come through the 6-foot tunnel, and out the other side it went up in the air for at least, I'm not exaggerating, at least 30 feet. The pressure behind it forcing it through. Terrific sight. The water had so much power, it made the bridge crack, and eventually the water got in it, so it broke the bridge all up. It's rather frightening to see the power of water when you see it like that. In the house, fish, eels, rats, everything you could imagine. It came on the 14th day of March 1947, and it never cleared the fen completely clear until that following Christmas.
This great bank along the River Ouse is a permanent reminder of the fragile existence of this part of the country. Yet the fens remain one of the most fertile areas of Britain, and I doubt if there are many who rue the day the Crown set about draining them.